some insects called the human race. Journey. On a strange journey. I would like, if I may, to take you on a strange journey. It seemed a fairly ordinary night when Brad Majors and his fiancée, Janet Weiss, two young, healthy, ordinary kids, decided to leave Denton that late November evening to visit a Dr. Everett Scott, ex-tutor and now friend to both of them. It's true. There were dark storm clouds, heavy, black, and pendulous, towards which they were driving. It's true also that the spare tire they were carrying was badly in need of some air. On a night out. It was to be a night out they would remember for a very long time. And so, after braving the inclement weather and some not too little time, it seemed that fortune had smiled on Brad and Janet, and that they had found the assistance that their plight required. Or had they? There certainly was something about this house, to which a flat tire and a wet night had brought them, that made the both of them uneasy. But if they were to reach their destination that night, they would have to ignore such feelings and take advantage of whatever help was offered them. Do pay attention.
It's just a jump.
It's just a jump.
It's just a jump. To the left.
To the left.
To the left. Hum and a hum and a hum and a hum and a hum. With your hands on your hips.
With your hands on your hips.
With your hands on your hips.
Rocky Horror, you need peace of mind. And I'm here to tell you that you're doing just fine. You're the product of another time and feeling down. Well, that's no crime. There are those who say life is but an illusion, and reality as we know it is merely a figment of our imaginations. If this is true, then Brad and Janet are quite safe. But there are some who have a more physical philosophy. Those who would stop at nothing to satisfy their base desire.
Ah. And then she cries out,
"Oh, hurry, or I may be dead." It could be that Brad and Janet are amongst those who hold the devil's reins. If and only two small words that kept repeating themselves again and again in Janet's thoughts. But it was too late to go back now, for it was as if she were riding against a giant tidal wave. It would be folly to fight against it. Her only chance would be to ride it out, adapt, and perhaps survive. Janet's feelings ran wild as she frantically manipulated the selector switch on her television monitor. The screen threw out images of empty rooms and corridors. Finally, she stopped at Frankenfurter's bedroom. If one is suffering from the pangs of remorse for a sexual indiscretion, it would seem logical that the transgressor would be sympathetic towards a loved one caught committing a similar misdemeanor. But he never caused her nothing but pain. But emotion is an irrational and powerful master. And from what Janet witnessed on her television monitor, he was a low-down, cheap little punk. There seemed to be little doubt that she was indeed its slave. Over? What was over? Brad and Janet's engagement? Their love for one another? Who could say? But questions such as these are not to be answered by academics. They must be left to the heart to solve. And Brad, you can be sure, had plenty of heart. Ah. And so, by some extraordinary coincidence, it seems that fate had decided that Brad and Janet should keep their appointment with their friend, Dr. Everett Scott. But it was to be in a situation which none of them could have ever possibly foreseen. And just a few hours after having announced their engagement, Brad and Janet had both tasted forbidden fruit. This itself was proof that their host was a man of little morals and of some persuasion. What further indignities were they to be subjected to? And what of the sonic transducer? And the floor show that had been spoken of? What? Indeed. From what had gone on before, it was clear this was to be no picnic. And crawling on the planet's face, some insects called the human race, lost in time and lost in space and in meaning.